When did you first learn you were drafted, and how did you feel?
I really kind of didn't get drafted. I volunteered for the draft. Me and another guy, Paul Frank, and we were playing football down at Snow, and I don't know, for some reason we decided we needed to join the Army. And so we did, and as far as how I felt about it, when we went to take our physical, you know, for the draft, I passed it, and Paul didn't pass because his pupils oblonged from, I don't know, I guess he got hit in the eye with a rock, but he had perfect vision. But I guess if your pupil's not round, you don't have to go in the Army.
Huh. Whoa.
But I saw his paper when he turned it in, and he had put in a football injury to the little finger, you know. Golly, wait a minute, bud. And the lady at the draft board, what we did is we volunteered on the buddy system, which meant, the reason why I didn't wait for the draft is, if you got drafted, you were in for 2 years. If you volunteered, you were in for 3 years, and I didn't want to be in for 3 years. But a lot of people volunteered for 3 years so they could choose a MOS. I don't know what MOS stands for anymore. It's your job title. That would keep you out of going overseas or whatever they call it. So we volunteered for the draft, and they had a lottery system. And my number was like 147, and it was off your birthday. What they'd do is they'd draw they would draw all the birthdays of the year, and born on July 10th, right?
12th.
July 12th. So if July 12th was the first date of the year drawn, you were for sure gone. Well, the year before, number 147 would have been drafted. And so, you know, I just thought, well, I'll just go in now, not wait for them to draft me. And they never did get to 147 that year.
But, really?
But the lady did tell me, she says, well, you know, since you volunteered on the buddy system, you do not have to go because your buddy's not going now. And I went anyway because I thought, I'm not going back to town.
Yeah.
See, well, you didn't think I was going to go if Paul didn't go. So I went along. How did I feel? Fine. I don't know.
What was basic like, and what fort were you at?
I was at Fort Lewis, Washington. And basic, I don't know, I didn't mind it. I mean, it was really hard for some people, you know. They had their favorites, and they picked the drill sergeants, you know, they're always yelling. And I've actually seen him yell at a guy till he cried, you know. I'd been yelled at enough that it didn't even bother me. I was fine with it. The other thing that happened to me is they had a PT test, you know, like you do for the, and I scored the highest in the whole company on it, which was kind of a mistake because then they all knew me in basic, but they did treat me better. Like when you'd line up for chow, they'd always put me, I got to go first.
Oh yeah.
Yeah, every day. But the funny thing about it was, is you take that PT test three times a year, or three times during your 8 weeks, and each time I took it, I got lower. I was in better shape when I went in than I was from, you know, just from working, you know. And, not a lot lower, but there's a possible of 500, and I think I scored 494 or something, and then it was 490 and then 480 something.
But, dang.
Yeah. The only advice I got before I went in that screwed me up on was Frank told me just don't do anything good, don't do anything bad, just blend in.
Yeah. Why was that bad advice?
No, that was good advice.
Oh,
it was. I made the mistake of
shining
on that, so that everybody knew me. But it didn't hurt me. They kind of treated me better.
Yeah. Did you have a least favorite instructor, drill instructor?
I only had one, and he was my least favorite. Oh, you know what? I take that back. There was another one. He was the real instructor, and he was a black guy, and I really kind of liked him. You know, but he had another black kid that was, I don't know what, it was his sidekick, and that guy, he was a mess. You know,
Okay. So, you said something about your MOS and didn't know what it was. Jet says, what was your MOS? Military Occupational Specialty.
Oh, okay, yeah, military. My MOS was 11B10, which is infantry all the way, infantry rifleman. There's an 11B12 that's infantry mortar, but those are your two infantry MOSs. I think it was 11B. Mine was 11B10, which is infantry. You just pack a rifle. And I guess the worst part about that is for 8 weeks, they told us we were going to Vietnam every day. You're going to Vietnam. Stay alert, stay alive. That's all they ever said. Stay alert, stay alive. And there were signs saying, stay alert, stay alive. You're all going. You're all going. And when our MOSs came out and they gave them to our company, for some reason they needed people in all these other occupations, and there were only two guys that ended up in infantry, and I was 11B10 and the other guy was 11B12. He was from Parowan, and so we were the only two that ended up in the infantry after they had told us all we were going for sure. Some of them, they were so varied too. Like, it wasn't that they all became typists or cooks or anything. One guy was a PE teacher back in in civilian life. And so for the next 2 years, he made up PT exercises.
Oh, no kidding.
Yeah. The guys were military police, a couple of them, military police, cooks. I mean, they were just everything you can imagine. But there were only two of us. And the worst part about that for me, I didn't mind that, other than they all went home for a 2 week. They don't call it vacation. What is it? Uh-huh. Leave. A 2 week leave before they went to AIT. That's advanced. Individual training.
Okay.
But mine was still at Fort Lewis because that's where they trained for the infantry. So I packed my bags and they put me on a bus and drove me across the base to a different barracks.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah. And since my name was Ballard, low in the alphabet, while they're waiting for other people to come in to start this new rotation, I was on KP. And then when they started the rotation, I was the first one to be on KP again, Jet.
So oh.
I didn't like that very good. And it happened to me everywhere I went.
Yeah.
Yeah. If you got there early, they'd put you on KP because you weren't assigned anywhere. And then when you got assigned, they started with your unit, and they went alphabetical order.
Makes sense. Where did you land when you first got to Vietnam?
It was called Benoit Air Force Base. And the thing I remember that about that is that I told you about the training. It was stay alert, stay alive. Well, I did not realize this, but Benoit was like landing at Salt Lake International Airport. You know, I mean, the chances of being, you know, something happening there were really slim. But I got off that plane, and the humidity and the stink just hit you in the face. I'd never felt humidity like that, because I'd really never been out of Utah a lot.
What was the stink like?
Burning diesel fuel. And
barrels of shit.
Barrels of shit. But, you know, it was... I don't know what they called that. It wasn't a Boeing 747, but it was a commercial aircraft we landed on. So, and I remember thinking, do I have to watch where I put my feet all the time so I don't step on some booby trap? Because they've been telling me about booby traps. And I thought that when I got there, that got out in the jungle, that I would only step where I saw the guy in front of me step. And that lasted about 5 steps.
Yeah.
And then you just, what the heck, you know. Yeah.
What'd you think of the helicopters?
You know, I loved them. I liked flying in them. I told you I used to sit on the floor of them with my legs dangling out the door, and I even got a picture of that of the day I left, and I'll give it to you, Jet. But they'd bank those helicopters, you'd be looking straight down. I don't know why. I was not nervous about that at all, but you know, you see those pictures of these helicopters coming in to you, you know, head first, and that whop, 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 whop. And I never hear a helicopter now that I don't think of that. You know, that whop, 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 whop of the helicopter just brings back some good memories, some bad memories, you know. Mm-hmm. But that's the thing that's Vietnam to me is the helicopter.
Really?
Whop, whop, whop. Huh. The sound of that helicopter making. That'll always... But we were an air mobile unit, the 1st Cav Air Mobile Division. You know, we didn't have tanks. We didn't have... We were... You know, we didn't have convoys. Everywhere we went was in the helicopter. And that's why it was called air mobile. Now, I don't know the difference between air mobile and airborne, because I wanted to say airborne. That sounded a lot better, you know. But we weren't. We were just air mobile.
Did you ever parachute and stuff?
I repelled, but I never parachuted. I never repelled out of a helicopter either. They took us up in towers and we repelled out.
Okay. Mm-hmm. How about, like, firefights out of helicopters?
Never. Yeah. Never. I was one night on a fire base that overlooked the jungle, and I saw this helicopter flying, and all of a sudden there were these green tracers shooting up at it. I guess the Viet Cong had green tracers. And then pretty soon these red tracers start shooting back down to the ground. Then the green tracers, you know, they were kind of hit and run, you know.
Yeah.
The Viet Cong. But, no, I never had a They called them a hot LZ landing zone. We never had one. And, yeah.
That's good. Why were you in two different regiments?
Well, I was there in 70 and 71. And that was when they were trying to bring troops home. And so I had one. I was in the 2nd or the 12th. I'm not sure what that stands for. 2nd Battalion, 12th Brigade, or 2nd Brigade, 12th Battalion. You know, I was 19 jet. Come on. So they stood down. And when I first got in country, in that 2nd of the 12th, we had like 20 guys to a squad or to a platoon, and each platoon had, gosh, maybe we had more than that. We had like 35 in each platoon, and then there were four platoons in a company, and then there are two squads in a platoon. And there would be like 8, 10, 12 guys in a squad. And by the time we left, and squads would go out and secure, you know, you'd hike all day, you'd set up camp like this, and you didn't talk. If you did, you whispered, you know, and no fires or anything like that. And you'd have, what are they called? It's been so long. Anyway, lookouts on your back trail, and you'd put out. And then your squad would go out maybe a quarter of a mile, you know, and they'd have coordinates. And then they'd go this way a quarter of a mile and then come back. And all four squads would do that, and so you'd know kind of what was up. And they got to where we only had about four guys to a squad, you know, so we went. So, because they would send them home, but they wouldn't replace it. So that was the 2nd of the 12th, and they finally, I think they call it standing down. They stood down. Then I was in the 2nd of the 5th. And I actually, between those two jobs, I had a job in the rear for about 6 weeks or something like that. And what I did there was, and it was back at Benoit, they'd have bands come and entertain the soldiers. And I worked for the club system. I hated it. I just hated it. I was so glad to get back out in the bush. But the worst thing about going back out in the bush was the day they sent me out, all my stuff had been, you know, I still had my pack and my, and I actually went out on my 20th birthday. I went back out in the bush on my birthday, and it was raining, and I had my hammock set up, and I crawled in my hammock, and the hammock had rotted because it was so humid over there, and the rope or something broke. And I spent the whole night just sitting there underneath my poncho liner.
Happy birthday.
Yeah, happy birthday. I talked too much. I didn't. I thought it'd be harder than this, Jet.
What was your weapon of choice?
I had an M16. And you only had like three choices. There was an M16, where you could carry the M60 machine gun. And it was a lot heavier. And then they had a 302 or something like that. And it had a M16. It was like an over and under shotgun, but it was an M16 on top and then a grenade launcher on the bottom. And the grenade launcher wouldn't launch a grenade, but it was like a shell that, I don't know, bigger than an egg, like maybe a turkey egg, and it just looked like a shotgun shell with the turkey egg halfway in it. But, and they didn't make any noise. It would go And that's when they always shot first, so that they wouldn't know where you were.
Oh, okay.
And then they had those little grenade launchers, but they didn't have a rifle, you know. And you'd hear them hit. But I got a funny story about that. If you want to hear it, Jip.
Oh yeah. Yeah, we want all the stories.
We were on a fire base. So out in the jungle, they have these fire bases, and that's where the mortar platoons and the artillery. No, not the mortar, just the artillery. And then all these different companies are out in the jungle all surrounding this fire base. And the fire base guys, they're artillery. And around the fire base are bunkers built out of sandbags. And so... those guys that were on there, we considered them rear, you know, working out of the rear. So when we'd get to the fire base, that's when we got to eat hot meals, you know, because they'd have a mess tent, you know, maybe kind of like the show mash, I don't know, maybe something like that. But we would pull guard for them at night. And so we were, not me, but some of the guys. No, it's when you could let your hair down a little bit. So anyway, we were letting our hair down, and we got to play in this game and see who could have that 302 stay in the air the longest. One. Mississippi 2, Mississippi 3. Then I'm going to go off, boom. And then we'd cheer for the other guy. And God, it was like 2 in the morning. We're still doing this. And finally, one of those guys that was asleep in his bunker, you know, I guess we'd kept him up. They started bitching. So we said, I'll bet we can do this in less than one Mississippi. Aim it this way, less than one Mississippi. They quit complaining. But
just shoot it at them?
No, we've never done that, but that's what the threat was. And they probably believed it because of how loud and obnoxious we were.
So Jet sent a picture of that Bowie knife and wants to know where that came from.
Okay, when I used to just have a machete when I was over there. Everybody, they just issue a machete. And a friend of mine had that Bowie knife. And then he went home and he gave it to me.
Okay. And that's the one you still have at your house?
Yeah.
Did you use it?
No. I used it over there a lot. Because I walked point, which is the first guy in line. And I did that because if you walked point, you didn't have to carry a Claymore mine, and you didn't have to carry M60 ammo. Everybody else had to carry M60. You know, those bandoleros of ammunition. But if you're walking point, you have to cut through the defoliated jungle, and you have to cut your way through to make a trail, unless you could find a trail. But you weren't supposed to walk on trails, because that's where they could put a trip line or anything like that.
Did you spend a lot of time sharpening them?
No. I don't know. Stuff wasn't hard to cut over there. It wasn't like dense. It was like, I don't know.
Okay, this picture. Jet wants to know where.
Oh.
Where was this taken?
I am not. I remember that picture when I took it. When we took it. We were getting picked up somewhere. And that's almost like a landing zone, but it wasn't. I mean, it was a... But there were villagers there. And what I really wish I'd have done is... There was a guy there with a big old muskox and one of those papasans.
Oh, yeah.
And he had a muskox, and this is a pretty safe area. But he had a muskox, and you could get on that muskox, and it'd take your picture first.
Oh, yeah.
I don't know how much. I kind of wish I would have done that, but I didn't take pictures. So that's where that picture was taken.
He wants to know, what does napalm smell like?
I don't know. Is that what they burn? Napalm is what burnt, right? Like it would hit and stick and burn.
I believe so, yeah.
Yeah, Jed, I think that was mainly World War II. If they did use it in Vietnam, I was never around it.
How about the guy that got hung upside?
Oh, yeah. Well, one time we were set up for the night and you know, just we had spent the night there.
You were out in the jungle.
Right? Yeah, but we were in a no fire zone, and that's a really weird rule they had. Like a no fire zone, you had to wait till the enemy shot at you before you could shoot back because there were civilians in the area. And we were in this place, and it was really kind of a pretty place, and there was not a highway, but a road that we could look across this, I'm going to call it a meadow, I don't know, it wasn't, and you could see every once in a while there'd be logging trucks or something going up and down that highway. Well, anyway, this friend of mine had to go to the bathroom, so, number two, and so... He goes and he walks out the trail, and we had a guy on observation post, you know, watching the back trail, and he says, I got to go to the bathroom, and he went past him, and he went out there, and he started to get off the trail, you know, so he could do his business, and he stepped in some kind of a snare. And it caught his foot and flipped him up in the air, and he was hanging up there upside down. He says, I was just waiting for the grenade to go off, you know. But what it was is there were wild pigs in the area, and those villagers had set a snare to catch wild pigs, and they caught him, you know, he got caught. But that same, we were in that same place, and I don't know, we never stayed in the same place two nights because that's bad business, you know. They know where you are, mm-hmm. So they can shoot mortars in or whatever. But for some reason, we stayed there two nights. And that road I was telling you about, all of a sudden, I don't know that we ever saw the vehicle, but, well, yeah, we did. It was kind of like a logging truck. But they stopped, and they just shot it our way, you know, into the trees, and then they jumped in and took, you know, they just took off, and we didn't even shoot back, you know, but we called in a helicopter, and that helicopter was there like this fast, and it was one of those Cobra gunships, you know, they're not very, I think they're only like 36 inches wide.
Oh, yeah.
And they'll shoot 18 rockets and 50 caliber machine gun. They say they can pass over a football field and put a round every 6 inches.
Oh, geez.
And I don't know how, you know. But anyway, they call it a Loach team because the Loach helicopter looks like a bubble with a little, it's just a little teeny thing. And they would fly really close to the tops of the trees, and if they got fired at, then Big Brother was up here, the Cobra, and that Loach driver come around, and he landed right in the middle of the road, right in front of that guy, and the Cobra gunship was up there just whop, 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 hovering over him, you know, just, and whoever, you know, whoever those guys were, they said, oh, we did not know anybody was over there. We were just shooting. And they had to let them go. Because, I don't know, it's just the way that war was.
Heard you took an air mattress ride.
Yeah. Okay, so I told you about the fire base where you went in and you pulled guard for the artillery people. Well, it must have just been a platoon that would go and pull guard for the fire base, and then you'd go back out in the bush, and then the next platoon would come in and pull guard. So there are five platoons in a company. I don't know what I told you before, but after each one of them's had their turn pulling guard for the fire base, then that company goes to a place called Vung Tau, and that's an in-country R&R, and it was on the beach, and it was just rest and relaxation. But you're on a beach, you don't even take your rifle with you, you know, you leave it, it's safe, you know. And there's a village there called Vung Tau, and it was really kind of pretty, you know. Like, if you went down the streets, there was a lot of French architecture, like restaurants where you ate out on a patio like they do in France. They'd be tiled, and you know, it wasn't like most of those. Well, anyway, there wasn't much to do but the beach during the day, and so then whatever you wanted to do at night. But I was floating on my air mattress and fell asleep at the beach. You know, we were all just... And when I woke up, I didn't... I don't know that I was really asleep or if I just closed my eyes and just forgot. But when I woke up, I couldn't hardly see land. I couldn't see the land. But I could... I guess I could barely see it or something. And so it kind of scared me, you know, being that far off the shore. And it was hard to get back to the inn.
I remember... Tell us about the time when you got the jungle rot.
I got... I don't know what jungle rot really is. I guess it's just sores from being wet and stuff. And I got it on my... where my belt goes. Where my belt went in my back. But I also got one right here on my wrist. And so I had to... So like you're out in the bush for 21 days straight, but every 3 to 5 days they bring you mail. They'll drop it off, you know, mail and your food and stuff like that. And then they'll come back later in the day and pick up what they brought it in. And that was by helicopters. And so they put me on one of those helicopters and sent me back to a good doctor instead of just a medic, you know, one that had, there was a trained doctor, you know, a doctor, not just a, I don't know what a medic is, somebody that had 8 weeks of training or something, you know, probably more than that. But anyway, while I was back there, my company walked into an ambush, and I guess it was my platoon. And the LT got killed. Got shot right above him, right in the upper lip, right there. It was, I guess it was a sniper, and he's up in the tree. And a couple others got got wounded. But the thing that's crazy about that story is I always walked point. I always did. And the reason why they got hit like that is they were going through the jungle and they hit some ants. You know, that a lot of ants were in the bushes and the trees. You know what I mean? Red ants, not Aunt Rhea's. But so I know me, you know, and the way Sterling taught us. I'll just top, you know, go through it. You know, like I can paddle my way through this. Leave me alone.
Yeah.
So. Anyway, they turned and turned, and when they turned, they went right into that ambush.
You was with them?
No, I was back. And I, you know, in some ways you're glad, but in other ways you feel guilty. Mm-hmm. Really, really guilty, you know. Like,
yeah.
These are some of the best friends you ever had, you know, because of what you go through together, you know.
Right.
So it's hard to win.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. I can tell you a funny story, Jeff. I've told your dad this one, but I was walking point and we were going down this. Even though you're not supposed to go on trails, we did sometimes. And we were going down this trail. I was really on the lookout because I was. You know, I did not know that the Ho Chi Minh Trail wasn't one trail. You know? It's just like a network where you come through Laos into Vietnam. But this trail was so used that I thought it was the Ho Chi Minh Trail. And I'm going down there and I see these Vietnamese up in these trees up ahead. And I got everybody, hey, whoa, get down there. Instead of being Vietnamese, they were monkeys. So.
Did you get any?
No.
How did the civilians treat you guys?
Yeah, they were fine. You know, I wasn't really around them that much. But most of the GIs treated them so bad, you know. That they weren't. We really did not get around the civilians. We were always out in the bush, except for when I had that job for the club system.
What about when you went on that little
R&R? Yeah, they're out for your money. Mm. You know, like in fact, they'd tell us, don't pay more than this, even though you got it, and it's hardly anything, you know, because. If you pay him this much for a whatever, I don't know what to say, but like a Hershey bar or something, you know. He said they're making more than their doctors, so don't screw up their economy. Mm. But we were really never around them. There were a couple times when I did go on a convoy at a truck, and those little kids would run out in the street, chop, 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 chop. They wanted food. Mm. We'd throw them sea rations. And
remember a story where you guys, were you getting fish and corn and stuff?
Oh, yeah. We were all set up for the night. It was on a bend in the river, and on this river, and like a lot of places over there are just beautiful, you know. In a way, I'd kind of like to go back, but we were in so many places that were just bombed out, and Agent Orange, where they'd sprayed defoliant, and so there'd be these skeletons of trees sticking up, you know, just the tree, and then there'd be instead of. They called it triple canopy, grass, bushes, and trees. All there was is, because it had been long enough, that just the bushes that were like 6 feet high, and you just had to cut your way through it. What was I going to say?
You guys found the corn and all that?
Oh, yeah. But this was a really pretty place. It wasn't defoliated like that. And there, we found this little corn patch in this neat little area. And they had different groups of Vietnamese people. And I think these were called mountain yards. And I don't know if they're similar to like hillbillies in Kentucky or what, but they weren't there. They'd abandoned this area. And so we picked this corn, and you know, you get tired of sea rations and lerps. We said, are there any fish in this area? I wonder if there's fish in here. And so we took a blasting cap. And you know, those lieutenants and sergeants, you know, they get pretty decent with you, you know, because you're just friends by now, you know, you aren't. It's not like back in the States where rank is everything. Mm-hmm. And took some C4 and put it around the blasting cap, cast it out, and then pushed the clacker. And this little Vietnamese, we had a Vietnamese guy with us they were called Kit Carson Scouts. And they were there to interpret for you and tell you if you were in the wrong place, you know, and whatnot. This one couldn't speak a word of English, so I don't know what good he was, but he stripped off faster than you could and dove in that water and started throwing fish out. Just, I never seen him ever smile until that day. He just was grinning and throwing those fish out to us.
Did you get in a fight one time over... Over some flares.
Oh yeah, there was not a fist fight. I got in one fight over there, but
let's hear about that.
Okay. Well, first of all, there's a backstory to it. There was this guy, and his name was George, and. We were setting up for the night, and this guy asked George, hey, can I borrow your knife? And he goes, sure. And he goes, like, here it is, you know, like I was going to stab him. And the guy took a step forward just as he did it, and he didn't mean to, and he stabbed him right in the chest, and it punctured his lung, and the guy died.
Really?
Yeah.
Much other people, you know, but
from around the country is you know, there's some, I don't want to get into like the bad stories, you know, but this one time, I told Matt about this, you know, and I'm sure he sees this in his work, but you know, you see so much crap that you kind of get to where you turn, cold?
Numb.
Hard to it. Yeah, you get to where, like Debbie says, how can people be so cruel? You know, how could they do these things? And I guess I wasn't there when it was so bad that, you know, that, did you guys ever hear of William Calley? You know, well, he was Lieutenant Calley. But they went into a village, and they just killed everybody, you know, and it was like the worst thing they could have done, you know, for the war, for them, for the war. And, you know, that's where the Vietnam soldiers got the reputation of being baby killers and all that kind of stuff. And they just had enough, you know, this village. Some of them, I'm sure, were innocent civilians, and some of them were Viet Cong, you know. And, you know, there were Viet Cong, then there's the NVA, North Vietnamese Army. Viet Cong were just sympathizers. but they'd still kill Americans.
You hearing that over there? Am I losing my mind?
Did you hear a scream?
No, I'm hearing a horse or something. He's over there stomping on Thad's tent.
Probably chewing on it.
Do you have any moments where you're scared?
You know, after maybe, but not during. Not scared, yeah.
So, switch to your childhood for a minute.
Okay.
Tell us about the Indians poking you.
Oh, shoot. Well, we were just little kids, me and Blaine and Vic and Roy, that's my cousins. And Francis Haskell used to have some migrant workers, and they were Navajos. And they used to come down to the house all the time, and Mom would feed them, but it got to where she had to quit, you know. And that was pretty intense for us, because sometimes they'd come down there and they'd be wearing those big old dark velvet dresses, and they'd been beat up, you know, like.
Really?
Yeah, maybe the dad or what. I remember one having her head in the sink and Mom washing the blood out of the back of her head. I don't know whether she got beat up or she fell down, you know. But anyway, I was afraid of them a little bit, but we still snuck through the cornfield one time when all the adults were gone. And we started throwing cobs of corn at the shack they had them living in. They were hitting that. And throwing them up on the roof. And my cousin Vic went up, run up to the door, and he was peeking through this knot hole in the door, and the little kid stuck him in the eye with his finger. Or a stick or something, I don't know. He came running back. Anyway, we were telling somebody about it, and Karen heard, so of course she told Mom, and we had to go make it right, you know, that we weren't going to treat people that way. And so we had to go pick out some toys to take up there. So we picked out toys of ours, and Karen drove us up part of the way, drove out in the field, and Blaine and I were supposed to take the toys. Man, I was scared. I just did not want to. But we knocked on the door and nobody's there, thank goodness, so we just left the toys. And,
you got lucky.
Got lucky, yeah. But when they all moved out, we went back up there and those toys were still, they were all broken, but they were there. Remember, we had a cash register. Of course, there's no cash in it. Just a toy cash register. That was there. Probably be worse than money now because it was all made out of tin. It wasn't made out of plastic.
Yeah, no joke. I don't remember the story, but Caitlin asked about stealing egg cartons.
Oh, Caitlin. God, you know, I really was a better kid than this. We didn't steal any, kind of, I guess we did. We used to have to go to primary after, it was like Tuesday nights, after school. And to get to the old First Ward Church, you could either walk up two blocks and down four, or you could go to my friend Keith Curtis's house and just kind of cut through the blocks. Well, back then, I don't think they even had garbage pickup, but if they did, these people didn't do it. They'd just burn their garbage in a burn barrel out back.
Mm-hmm.
And as we were cutting through the yard, there was this egg carton there, and I don't know why it was an egg carton that only held six eggs. I'd never seen one. I thought egg cartons had to hold 12 eggs. And then, so I picked up that egg carton. I'm sure it was there. just didn't burn, you know. But I thought I was stealing it. So I put it under my coat and I went to primary. the whole day of primary. Good morning. I'm gonna someday write a history.
Floppy disks aren't a thing anymore.
Yeah, floppy disks.
This is Army Sergeant Stephen M. Sanders, and we have a heavy up for you next.
Training sports in high school.
Yeah. That chicken man's contribution this evening is not available. He's out celebrating. Glenn Campbell, Galveston, Galveston, a small island off the coast.
I still see her dark eyes glowing.
We didn't have a rest.
She was 21.
Well, we did.
I left Galveston.
Go to high school
in
Payson.
Yeah.
Oh, you did?
The cannon flashing. I paint my gun and dream of Galveston.
You played football?
Well, actually, I never rode you on the top of the water. That's when I realized I hated sport. Because rodeo was so much, I just loved it.
So fun.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. The people were better. They weren't jocks. They weren't.
Yeah, your competitors are your best friends.
Yeah.
Yeah. That is so awesome.
Like Matt and I were talking today. In rodeo, you're not waiting for some guy to tell you you're good enough to go in.
Yeah. Right. You know,
if you can get yourself to the rodeo, pay your fees, you can play.
Yeah. Good luck, cowboy.
Yeah. In fact, they prefer the ones who can't.
Sweeten the pot.
There's absolutely no off time. It's not like you get to walk off the job and go somewhere else. You know, you're out in the jungle. It's like a 365 day camping trip. You know, but in some ways there is off time. You know, like a typical day jet, we would get up and we'd break camp, and you got to understand that when you break camp, you aren't talking or anything, and if you do, you just whisper. And we just never were loud, and so you'd fix you something to eat, and you'd talk and carry on, and then there was some patrol you had to go on, you know, and each day you would move to a different location, and set up a new campsite, so to speak. They call it a perimeter. But we would set up for the night. We'd have our duties, and you know, somebody would be out doing guard. You'd set up your perimeter with trip flares and claymore mines, so that if the enemy tried to come into your camp at night, they'd hit a trip flare, hopefully, and they'd get caught. You know, you'd be busted, and then you'd have your claymore mines. But by the same token, okay, I don't really know. I started to tell you a day, what a day was like. So
while, start over. You get up, you sleep in your clothes. You never do take your clothes off, you know.
Yeah.
Sometimes you take your boots off and change socks and stuff like that, but we just slept in our clothes. You didn't wear underwear, so because you'd get rashes and stuff from it, so. But anyway, there I go off on the subject again. So you get up, you get your breakfast, and then you tell you, okay, we're gonna leave in 15 minutes. We're gonna be back out on patrol. So then you patrol and you patrol, or at least go through the jungle. I'm not sure what we were doing. Just securing an area, you know, so from a village or whatever. Then you would stop and have lunch, and then you'd hike some more. And usually, Jet, like by, especially during the monsoon seasons, you'd be trying to be set up by 2 o'clock in the afternoon. So at 2 o'clock in the afternoon, you'd set up, you'd set up your little camp and again, you know. And it's not like, I don't know, it's hard to explain. It's not like when you set up camp up the canyon, you know, camp, and you just hung a hammock and or whatever you slept in. Some people slept on the ground because they didn't want to be up in the air. And then there'd be people that would, when you'd set up for the night, then they'd send out, you'd move as a platoon, but then they'd send out little squads to just see that you didn't set up 200 yards away from the enemy, you know, where they were. So then they'd patrol that area, and then they'd come back. That usually only took 45 minutes to an hour, you know, to have all the different squads go out and make sure your area was... Am I making sense?
Yeah, no.
Yeah. Okay, so then you'd come back, and then you'd have them then until... You know, people had their jobs. There was somebody on the back trail, you know, that was pulling guard. And so you would just talk and play cards, write letters, you know, whatever you wanted to do like that. You know, if you imagine some of those movies where they, in fact, a lot of times, a lot of people have this misconception that when you're at war, you're shooting at each other the whole time, when a lot of times it's just really boring, you know, and really, you know, you get, I don't know why, I would be more homesick now than I was then. I mean, I was only 19, turned 20 while I was over there, but we made good friends, and then there would be a day every 3 days when the helicopters would come in and drop us off food and take our mail out. I mean, we just patrolled the jungle, you know, areas in the jungle. And so I think your original question is, what did you do in your off time? We had some off time, but usually we just played a lot of cards, and there was a game called spades. We played a lot of spades. I don't even know if I can remember how to play spades now, but that's what we did. And then you do those little, they called them rickies, you know, those little patrols I told you, the squads. We called them light fight. So you didn't carry your pack when you did that. You just took your rifle and your ammunition. So we kept busy, but there was a lot of times you didn't do anything, and there were a lot of days in a row that's all you did. We just move and move and move. And we moved every day. We never stayed in the same place 2 nights. That's bad business. Do you know why?
Because mortars.
Yeah, they could figure out where, if they knew right exactly where you were, they'd wait till the next night. And if you were still there, they'd know exactly your coordinates. That answers that question. Man, that was a long answer for a short question.
No, I like the long answers. Okay. So, do you ever have any run-ins with animals?
You know what? I saw some big lizards, really big lizards, and snakes. But every once in a while, we would get on an elephant trail. And that was nice because you didn't have to cut your way through. And those elephants make a really good trail. You know, they stomp it down, you didn't. But as far as being attacked, I told that one story about
the monkeys,
but no, I was never attacked. We did see some little snakes over there. They're about, how long is that? Less than a foot long. And they were kind of a fluorescent green color.
Huh.
And they were called bamboo vipers. And they were supposedly very, very poisonous. And I think I saw maybe two of those, but that's all I saw. And one time we were going through and there was a lizard. I don't know what kind of lizard it was. What's that? 3 feet long.
Holy crap.
It kind of looked like a little dragon or something.
Yeah.
And we pointed it out and said, hey, right there. You know, just pointed it to the guy behind us so that he'd know it was there. But it just stayed there like it was asleep, like a sleepy old lizard. But never was attacked by him. Now, my brother Frank, he said they had, where he was stationed, you know, they had what they called rock apes. And they were kind of like monkeys, or, and they'd throw rocks at them. The apes would throw rocks at them. But anyway, that's the end of that answer.
Yeah.
That question.
I got one more.
Okay.
What was your favorite memory?
Oh, man. Coming home, I guess. I had some really good memories. I mean, the friends you make, but you know, your whole idea is wanting to come home. I think the one I remember, besides the worst day of my life over there, the best day might have been that day that we camped on that bend in that river, and I told you we got some fish. And every once in a while you'd get a letter from home that would just make your day, you know. You know, Jet, there were so many things I can remember now. When I answered these questions for Matt out on the desert, or out at Cedar Mountain, it just brought back a flood of memories of things that I could have told and talked about. I remember one time we set up for the night, and we'd set up in a circle. You know what I mean?
Yeah.
And in the center of the circle would be the lieutenant, you know, the radio operator and that, and the riflemen were on the outside. Well, we set up the circle, me and this friend of mine, and we were clear outside the circle. We didn't realize we were outside the circle. We were probably 25 yards too far. But we just kept looking for a better place to set our camp, and that's where it ended up. I hardly even knew it, didn't care, but it bugged him all night long. He hardly slept because he felt like we were just the two of us out there by ourselves. I told you that story about that guy, that captain that tried to give me a hard time for being a Mormon.
Yeah.
And I didn't like him anyway, so I wasn't going to back down from him, and it ended up being that I think he respected me a lot more afterwards, because he was a Mormon too.
Oh, yeah.
He was just a, what they call a Jack Mormon, you know, wasn't active. And he never, ever walked again. Another favorite thing that happened to me is every once in a while they had a newspaper over there called the Stars and Stripes, and they wanted to soldier of the month for this whole battalion. And to be a soldier of the month, you had to answer a lot of questions, do an interview, and so rather than just open it up to the guys in the rear, they opened it up to the guys out in the bush. And I don't know, I don't know why they chose me, but anyway, they chose me to go in and represent. But all it was for me is a chance to get out of the bush. I didn't want to be soldier of the month.
Yeah.
But anyway, when I got back there, they asked questions that I had no way of knowing, because we had been cut off from the world. That's what we called it, getting back to the world, getting back to the United States. We called that the world. I don't know. They ask questions about the government, you know, like at that time they were wage and price freeze and stuff like that. I'm not so sure I would have understood that had I been back in the rear where I could read a newspaper once in a while, but I'd never even heard of it. And they asked a lot of current events type stuff, and we had no way of knowing about current events, so I surely didn't win that contest. But I got to go back for 3 days, and that was kind of fun.
So on that note, what did you think of the press coverage of the war?
That was the coverage of that war is what made it so unpopular. You know, like every other war, they just reported it. But in Vietnam, they brought it into your living room every night. Every night. And see, I knew this because my brother was over there before me, my brother Frank. And so every night we'd watch the news of these soldiers, army, and marines, and whatever. They were in firefights, and they'd give you the body count. 267 people were killed today, and every day it was like that. And it just made people hate that war even more. They already hated it. And yeah, the press coverage is what was really tough. You know, other wars, World War II, World War I and stuff, they show reels, you know, and you see the devastation. But this was happening live, so that's what the press coverage was. Now, some of these things are my opinion, so I, you know, like when I say that's what really made that so unpopular, that's my opinion. I don't know that that's...
Well, really you were good. There, so I'm going to trust... I'm going to take your opinion over some historian.
Yeah, that's pretty much... You know, every night, though, that war came right into your living room back home. So, yeah, the press coverage was amazing. There were journalists assigned right to your units.
Oh, wow.
That were out there hiking. I never was with one, but, you know, because there aren't that many journalists, and there were a lot of units.
Yeah, I'm sure.
But some of them had they called them war correspondents. So they had a camera crew, and some of those guys got killed too. You know, I mean, it's not like they, you know, you could be a reporter and get killed. You didn't have to be shooting a gun. Okay, that's...
Yeah. Thank you, Grandpa, so much.